Now, if you can hear me, thank you for being here with us at this new event on quality in e-learning. The event is offered by Eden within the network of academics and professional proposals for professional development. I have a brief, very brief presentation just to remind all of you about what we do as Network of Academics and Professionals within the Eden framework, within our association. So as you know, every other Wednesday during the two semesters, we have the possibility to support individual members through the possibility to participate in our webinars in particular, which are so much appreciated and welcomed by the community. The Network for Academics of Academics and Professionals is, of course, devoted to establish a relationship with the membership, is coordinated by a steering committee, and actually our keynote today has been part of the Network of Academics and Professionals steering committee for a long time. The Network for Academics and Professionals, of course, provide information for members and opportunity for professional actions. It helps members to build their own portfolio. It promotes communication, as I was saying, networking, increase coherence of Eden as a learning community. That's what we really want. And it helps, of course, finding partners within the membership to develop research and research projects in particular. Here you have a picture where all of us are represented. I see that also Don Olcott is online at the moment and is part of our steering committee. Also Alfredo should be somewhere, Alfredo Soero, Elga Dorner, Wendy Chowney, Elspeth Korsgaard Sorensen, and Alastair Krillman. During the various sessions, you will have the opportunity to meet the other members of the steering committee who will participate and hosting these events from time to time. Here you have a picture of the members area where I really suggest and support you in participating, giving your information, being part of the community, and so taking part in the area, in the devoted area. There are different benefits in being part of our community, in being active part in our community. Of course, as I was saying, being active and having the possibility to communicate with the other members, access the Eden's database. As member institutions, you can delegate up to 30 individuals in the net. You can attend conferences at reduced fees, establishing partnerships, free access to electronic versions of Eden conference proceedings, use the logo, have, you know, receiving regular updates, news flashes about what's going on within our community. Of course, purchase at discounted rate our publications, have access to the online bulletin board. So there are so many advantages of being part of such a community that you really need to participate and be part of that. We have been working hard in the recent years time in improving our offer to the membership. We have been trying to be active in establishing relations and listen to members' ideas and support interaction, especially through webinars as this one, but also through our hidden chats that are a good opportunity to exchange ideas, links, researches, even if in a brief space. In a limited space, but it has been proved to be very effective. I just want to remind you of the European Distance Learning Week that, as every year, has been organized and where NAP, Network of Academics and Professionals, is of course taking part and offering a devoted space. If you go to the website, you can find the indication of the various appointments during the week from November 11th to November 15th. Within that week, we will take part in different events, but there's one specifically devoted to and offered by NAP, Network of Academics and Professions. I don't want to steal more time to Heba, who is there, and I thank her so much because she is in Turkey. She's away from home, and actually she's at the conference, and she just ended another keynote. So thank you so much, Heba, for giving us this opportunity and for offering this webinar of yours on quality in e-learning. Thank you so much, and the word to you. Thank you.
Thank you so much, dear Antonella, for first for your kind invitation and asking me to give this webinar on behalf of Eden NAP. And yes, I am in Turkey for the moment, and I have just given another keynote presentation about quality and online learning and the challenges ahead. So also all of you who are here present today, a warm welcome to you. I think I have seen all the names already and have greeting you personally in person as well. So very much welcome. It's a great pleasure for me to take part in those Eden NAP webinars, and I do it with great pleasure. As Antonella said, I have been in the Eden NAP steering committee for some years. I'm now in the Eden EC executive committee, and I'm also in the Eden sharing the Eden special interest group about technology-enabled learning and quality enhancement. So we will have this webinar for approximately 1 hour, and I will give some time in the end, of course, to have a discussion and question, time for questions, but you also are very much welcome to write your questions in the chat, and I will try to keep an eye on that. First of all, is my voice good for you? I can continue like this? It's good? Okay, I continue. I would also like to remind you that later tonight we have an Eden chat, a follow-up from this webinar. So you are most welcome back in some hours, and maybe someone is coming for the Eden chat. We Eden app used to do these tweet chats as well, and I think it's a very good opportunity to have it directly after the webinar, because then there are more time to discuss things and to share links and to share ideas, etc. Yes, I thank you, Rita, and Antonella for the feedback. I'm just seeing here what the secretary is writing about it. Twitch chat. And I have prepared for that some questions. So it is like we have some questions, we discuss, and then we discuss lively. And as it is a tweet, we don't just have, you know, those signs which are limited. Okay, by that, so a warm welcome to you all again, and I hope we'll have a nice discussion, and looking forward to contribute, to collaborate, and to hear your contributions. So I am from Sweden, from Lund. I have a long experience from Lund University, but also many of the other universities in Sweden. I left 5 years ago, so now I'm an independent researcher and consultant, both for at national level, but mainly actually at the international level. And I do a lot of work for Eden, which I do with great pleasure. And I also work with the ICDE, the International Council for Open and Distance Education. And I work with the EADTU, which is the European Association for Distance Teaching Universities. And my special area is about quality related issues in open online learning and e-learning. I also do some work for ISO, and both at national level, for national level, but also on behalf of Eden, actually. Yes, I think most of you who are here today, I think you know me and know what I'm doing and following me. So the agenda for today is to first of all set the scene. I will present something about open online learning and e-learning, about personal responsibilities, about formatives versus process-based quality assurance and enhancement. I will argue that we need to redefine the quality issues and really strongly look at the questions like the elephant's five best friends: what, why, who, whom, when. And then I also will give some perspectives on the different kind of levels, the nano, micro, meso, and macro level. And also about current discourse and quality and how we can work on sustainable quality in education and e-learning, open online learning. So I hope you are fine with that. And as I said, connecting to this, I have prepared some questions for the Eden chat later tonight, so it will continue. So first to set the scene. We are all facing those three global challenges about demography, about globalization, and digitalization. And those three I mentioned, I mean, you can't go to any conference today without mentioning those ones. Demography is because we are really changing the age of the people. People are living longer, people are doing education for longer time, people are, lifelong learning is emphasized, and people need to go back and forth to universities or other educational sectors. And then we have the globalization. People are really mobile today. First of all, you're not just working in living in your own city or village, or you're not even country. You need to learn wherever you are. People are traveling to a very high extent, and they are living in different kind of regions, continents, and still they need to continue their education. And then, of course, we have the digitalization, which really is a huge issue and will really change a lot of things in our societies and also when it comes to learning. And we'll come back to that more in detail. But this is the background. And also about the future, the kids today, they are grown up with all this kind of digital devices and the digital era, so they have different kind of demands than we had when we were a child and when we entered the university. And we are often talking about the future, but actually the future started from yesterday, so we have to work not just for the future, so to say, but we need to act today. And that is urgent. That is urgent because the UNESCO and the United Nations have raised the SDG goals, and they have especially one dedicated for education, and that is number 4. And that means that education needs to be accessible for all by 2030, and that is just 10 years ahead. And the core pillars are about access for to education, access not just in time and space and the path, but also to have really access by preferable open resources to get all the information which are available. And then another key issue is about equity and inclusion, to get everyone on board. Quality is one of the issues, and it is so important, so it's actually an own core pillar. And lifelong learning I have talked about already. That means that we really need to organize and to offer educational offers and possibilities throughout the lifespan, from early kids to just until you're dying. So it's not just a special group who are lifelong learners, it is all of us. And then the last one is about gender and equality. And education is so important, so actually it has an effect on all the other 16 SDGs, and that was the reason why they decided to have a special one on education. And I never talk about quality nowadays without mentioning this, because it is so crucial and so important to bear in mind and have as a background. And then also we have the fourth industrial revolution, who also will change a lot of how we work, how we perform, how we live, how we communicate, how we perform, how we relate to each other, but also in to the highest extent how we are learning. And that is also changing a lot, as there are so many new possibilities for learning. And sorry to say, but I think this area is not so much discussed as the other one. Nowadays it is, it's common for all of us to use our mobile whenever and to whatever kind of issues we need to do. We book our hotels, we see Netflix, we book our Uber taxis, and then we get food, and we get, everything is online nowadays, everything is mobile, and we have changed a lot of patterns. So there is actually saying that there needs to be some kind of Netflix for education as well, and then what now that can be. Why is it important to talk so much about open online learning and e-learning? Now, the main reason is because it is about social justice. And we also need to talk about the big picture of open education at all kind of levels. Macro, meso, micro and nano. And also there are different perspectives of the economical, cultural and political perspectives. And there are different kind of scenarios for that. So when we talk about quality, it is at all those levels, and that's why I often got a question. So what is quality and what is good quality? It's not an easy question to answer, because it depends quality for whom, quality at which level, quality from which kind of perspective. So there are many questions before you can actually say what is good or better or best. However, there is a very nice model from the European Commission about open education, which shows how you need to think about it as an ecosystem. This one about the 10 dimensions of open education has four transversal dimensions, and that is leadership, strategy, technology, and quality. And then the core dimensions are about content, pedagogy, recognition, collaboration, research, and access. So each of them are interconnected, both between them, but also, for example, leadership is a question on how you deal with content, for example, and open content. And also leadership is a question on how you perceive quality and what kind of quality strategies you have. So they are all interconnected. And that means that you need to have this holistic perspective and to see the ecosystem. Actually, this model is very useful because not just because there's a lot to read about it, but rather recently, the European Commission have come out with a self-evaluation tool. So you can actually measure your own performance within your institution on all those dimensions. I have been involved in the issue of the quality area, so I work together with the European Commission with that. But it is a good tool if you would like to, you know, to benchmark yourself where you are at and what you can do to improve or to enhance the quality in your organization. The title for this presentation was e-learning, and I think it is important, not I just think it is important to see what we're talking about, because e-learning was, I mean, the word in the beginning of the 80s, and we are still talking about e-learning, but e-learning has changed a lot during those almost 20 years. And there's also different definitions if you talk about e-learning in the educational sector or if you talk about e-learning in the more commercial and corporate sector. I think you can just read yourself. Here are some definitions from the Wikiversity. But just to summarize, we used it to talk about e-learning. That means that learning is through digital technology in one or another means. And that is rather wide, so it can be anything and nothing. We also talk about blended learning. And some people say that is maybe most educational sectors, they use blended learning today. And that is a mix about classroom, face-to-face education, and e-learning. So it's also a form of e-learning. If you're more interested about more about that, I wrote a report on behalf of ICDE last year to get a state of the art about blended learning. So that is also a concept we use when we talk about e-learning. Another concept is ubiquitous learning, and it's also hybrid learning. So there are, and also mobile learning used to be mentioned in those in this context. So we need to know what we are talking about. We are doing a lot of work in EDAN on those issues. I mentioned that I'm chairing the EDAN Special Interest Group on TEL and Quality Enhancement. And TEL is another concept we use when we talk about e-learning. Sometimes it used to be a more wider and broader perspective, and this is the definition by Commonwealth of Learning, that TEL includes a wide range of technologies for teaching and learning, online access, mobile devices, and low-cost technologies, such as audio, video, and radio, TV, etc. I don't know, you are here in the audience, which kind of concept you are more familiar with, or if you use everyone or at the same as they are similar, we can discuss that. Or you can write, you're welcome to write in the chat if you have any ideas about it. This will also be discussed to you in the chat tonight. Although we talk about online learning and e-learning or whatever concept we use, there are strong initiatives, not at least from the European Commission, that maybe we shall stop to talk about it as a special area, because online learning and training today is not just a simple matter of digitalization. It is the way learning is carried out today. So the European Commissioner, Ferrari, she stated in June at a conference I participated in, that we need to see the shift from digital learning towards learning in a digital world. And that means that there are no needs any longer for digital strategies or digital quality enhancement or whatever, because it is about learning in a digital world and strategies in a digital world. So that makes also the sense that we need to change our perspectives. Another issue that we need to change our perspective is about personal learning, because today universities and school educations, they are offering a lot of things and courses or degrees or whatever it is, which they think are needed out there. But that is not the case any longer, and not at least from the corporate sector and the labor market. Because as you know, many companies nowadays, they have their own academy because they would like to educate their own staff, so to say, with their special skills and attitudes and values and context. But they would like to have people who have who are social attractive and who are entrepreneurs, who are problems, can manage problem solving, and yeah, a lot of soft skills. So the question is very much, if education is not aiming to just educate people to get some kind of degree or to get some kind of job, what is the purpose of education? And then we need to organize, and when we talk about quality, we need to focus on the needs to equip students with skills and attitudes and competencies, so they can become active and responsible lifelong learners and engaged citizens, because engaged citizens are needed in the society in each of our countries to make a difference. So what is the role of education? That is also a question about when we talk about quality and how we measure quality. The European Commission have also come out with or manifested the key competences which are needed in a digital society and in the 21st century. I think you're all familiar with this kind of image, that there are both about the subject as such. It is about literacy, it is about cultural awareness, it is about citizenship, entrepreneurship, etc. More so called soft skills. And they also need to be integrated within a course or within the model or whatever it is. I think we have seen this this image before, so we're not going too much into it. But I mentioned personal learning. Today there are more demands and higher demands that the individual as such, they need to learn what they need, and anywhere, anytime, by anyone. So with personal learning, it's more about that the learners are picking what they are needed to get the passion of learning, and not just that with personalized learning to get offers from the educational settings. Stephen Down, who I think all of us know more or less and have met many times, he has a very interesting distinctions between those. Personal learning is more like go to the marketplace and you pick your own things and then you can prepare your food at home or together with friends or whatever, where personalized learning is more like to choose from a menu with some kind of fixed dishes. And that is what educational institutions actually are doing. They are offering courses, they are offering modules, they are offering something. So that is also a question of quality. How can we embrace the issues of personal learning within our educational systems? And also we have different kind of learning spaces, of course, informal and informal learning. And not at least we have the issue of engagement, and that is a real quality aspect, because when you're engaged, here you can see Greta Thunberg, she's from Sweden, as you know, but she learns a lot by herself because of her engagement, and she learns a lot of things which she really can't do in school. I mean, I'm not saying that everyone should be like her, but I'm saying that if you have some kind of engagement, you can almost learn everything. And if you have the passion of learning, then you also can learn everything. So that means that quality is an issue of how we can offer engagement learning activities and learning environments. So now we'll come back to more to talk about what are we talking about when we talk about quality. This is some kind of background which is important to have as a framework when we're talking about quality, because it is embedded. So we used to separate between norm-based versus process-based approaches. A norm-based It's more like, you know, about there are different kind of standards, there are different kind of dimensions, there are different kind of indicators. It is often by quality assurance agencies or quality assurance for higher education, for example. If someone is coming from some kind of agency, someone from above, so to say, and make some kind of measurement, is this good or is it bad? Does it fulfill the standards with special indicators? While process-based quality is more about enhancement. It's not what has been done, it is what should be done, like a process. And so that is also some kind of difference when we are talking about quality. What do we really mean? Me and my research team, we did a study in 2015, and we studied quality models around the globe. And so this is described also in this report from ICD, because it makes sense to see how they are different, if it is more like assurance, as I said, or if it's more like benchmarking, more about quality enhancement, more about guidelines, frameworks, etc. So the question is, how can we make it sustainable as well? It's not just as I was saying, the more norm-based, you have more ticking of boxes, and that's maybe not so sustainable. You need to ensure that everyone working in the context of education or in the institution need to have and feel the quality by hands and in the heart and in the head. I can give you one example of that. As I work as a quality reviewer, I have done 3 years ago, I did a review for Universitas Terbukas in Indonesia, and I would do that again in December because they have to renew their quality label every third year from ICD. And when we were there last time, Universitas Terbukas they have 500,000 of students, and they have 1,700 islands. And they have around 40 learning centers on the largest islands. And we work with focus groups, all kind of staff, students, alumni. We also visited those learning centers on the islands. And I have never, ever been at an institution where whoever I met, everyone had quality by heart, by mind, and by hands. Everyone knows exactly what was going on within the institution and what was the focus and how they could contribute to the common work for the whole university. I think you have been in the same situation, which I have been many times. You know, it's not my department. It's we have a reorganization. We have a new boss. We have that and that. And they are, you know, have excuses all the time why things are not functioning. But that was not the case at University of Bucharest, which I mentioned, because they had a quality as a core issue at the university, and it was in their culture. So I think the culture is very, very, very important when you talk about quality. It's not just about ticking boxes. It is about develop a culture, and that is why everyone is included, and not at least the manager and leadership. You remember that this model I showed you earlier on about the 10 dimensions, where leadership have an impact on all the other kind of dimensions. I'm not saying that the leaders are the only one, but they're very important. And in this case of Universitas Terbukas, for example, their rector, she was very keen to involve each and everyone to build the quality culture of the university. Okay? So what do we mean by quality? There's also a lot of definitions. The easiest definition is, of course, quality is in the eyes of the beholder. That is the easiest one. And the more complicated one is about that it is about compliance and consumer protection. It is about enhancement or improvements, as we discussed. That is about repetition. So again, first we have many definitions about e-learning. Then we have also many definitions about quality. So we need to understand what we are talking about. And then I will come back to Sir John Daniel. I think also most of you know him. He came out with this, the Iron Triangle, in 2013. You see the triangle, they have three sides, and it is about access, it is about quality, and it's about costs. And if you extend one of those, then the other will change their shape. So this is rather easy. For example, if you extend access, more education to more people, you have to scale it. Then, of course, costs and quality may be changed as well. And vice versa for the other ones. So you need to have some kind of balance. And this shows, again, very easy how you need to see the ecosystem. Because if you change something in one end, there will be changes in the other ends as well. I mentioned the UN SIG on talent quality enhancement already several times, and our SIG is aimed to advocate and work for renewing the quality agenda in education. And that is one reason, of course, why we have this webinar and the chat later on. And we have also had other webinars on this topic to advocate for it. But our strong belief is that the TEL can facilitate to promote the goals for SDG 4 on equity, quality, and equality. I'm referring again to Agnieszka Ferrari, the commissioner. She strongly emphasized that there are strong needs for new teaching and learning methods, and there are also needs for new pedagogical approaches, like open pedagogy, for example. And there maybe will be also new subjects and disciplines due to the digitalization and globalization and the change demography, those global changes. Not at least as the working life is changing that much, so maybe there will be need. There is a need to have other kind of subjects, for example, at the universities, and also maybe other kind of contents. For example, those more about the 21st century skills and core domain, core skills for the 21st century, for the 21st century. Here I mentioned this report again. What we came up with was that most of those 40 models were quite similar, although they came from different kind of continents and different kind of educational sectors. But there are were some common issues and some common dimensions. First of all, they need to be multifaceted. They need to serve different kind of purposes, as quality, as we have been discussing, are seen at different kind of levels. And also they need to be dynamic to embrace all those kind of new things. For example, we are now facing with artificial intelligence and robotization and gamification, and yes, you can make the list rather long. And also it needs to be mainstreamed, and to build this, as I talked about the university book, as about the culture of equality to each and everyone who's working within an organization. And of course they need to be representative and multifunctional. So some of those common issues for all those over 40 plus models, they both mentioned the macro level, meso level, micro and nano level. And we talk about macro level. It's mainly on the either national level, for example, authorities for higher education or the school sector, or even from the government. Meso level is more for the institution, while micro level is more for the course, and nano level is for the individuals, as each of us are bearing the quality culture. But all those 40 models, they had six or three areas which were in common, and that was and you can see here that this is similar with the open education models with the 10 dimensions. It is about leadership, management, strategies. It is about the course as such, curriculum, course delivery, course design. It is about the support for students and for staff. So again, if you can have whatever kind of high quality on a course, but if the student support or the staff support are limited, you will not say this, because the quality is like that, that the nothing is as strong as the weakest link. So are the weak links for professional competence development, for example. Then it will be very hard to have good quality in a course. And the same if you can have the best LMS ever, but if the support or the infrastructure for running it are failing, then it will fail and students will complain. But what was also interesting and what we have worked with since this study is to see from the learner's perspective, and learners are demanding a lot of other things than maybe the institutions are offering. They are demanding flexibility. They are demanding transparency in e-learning. So they can know what they can take responsibility for and what they can manage and what they can orchestra themselves. They need, of course, to feel trust to the course and to the course provider. It needs to be accessible, of course, in all means. And those are just some of the dimensions. And rather seldom they are mentioned in as indicators in quality metrics. However, ENQA, the European Association for Quality Assurance in Higher Education, you know, they're working with this European standard guidelines since 2015, and the most universities in Europe, at least, they are following them. But what they have done the last year is to have they had a working group about considerations for quality assurance of e-learning provision. And actually the background for that was that there was a project with together with EID2U and with ENQA about quality in e-learning. So actually these considerations are based very much about from the e-excellence, which is a quality framework by EID2U. Maybe some of you were at our webinar when we had a special webinar about those considerations. It was last year, I think, Antonella, wasn't it? I think so. So actually I have borrowed some of the slides which we presented at that webinar to get an overview of what this considerations is about. As I said, it's built on the ENQA, European Standard and Guidelines from 2015, and it's also based on the e-excellence, which is the excellence label for e-learning in higher education, and that is a benchmarking model. And benchmarking means that you do your self-evaluation, so you can see yourself where you have your strengths and where you have your weaknesses. And also, you can get guidelines what you can improve. And when you do the benchmarking and the self-evaluation, then you are more keen to make improvements instead of someone from some kind of quality assurance agency are coming to your university and say, hi there, you have to do that and that and that. So it is a generic model. It is for all higher education institutions. It is all types of e-learning. We talked about in the beginning that you can define e-learning in different kind of ways. What is also good with this one is it is because it is all types of quality assurance, and they also stress both the internal quality work but also the external. And as we know the internal quality work within institutions are quite good and quite proactive in this area, but what is missing very much is about the knowledge and the competences from, for example, quality assurance agencies at higher education, because they don't know so much about e-learning and online learning. So they need to have frameworks and they need to have help. So here are some guidelines in this report on that. Have anyone seen it? Is anyone working with it? Okay, just some open questions.
It's very important document.
Thank you, Antonella.
It is a very important document.
That is. And that's why I decided to talk quite a bit. Okay. So that was the reason why I decided to talk a lot about this, because I think it is a very useful instrument and tool to be more involved in the quality issues, what you have to think about and how you can perform. So we will see what it will tell us. It is one part for the internal quality assurance, as I said, and one part for the external quality assurance. And then there are one part we really address the issues for quality assurance agencies, which is really, really important, as I mentioned, because they have no competence in this area. And I think also that is an issue for all of us who are interested in quality, that we need to work together with them to help them get an understanding what e-learning is about. So it is divided. I will not go into detail here with this, because but I will just show the structure. So you see the structure again for the internal quality assurance. They are, you see there's the European standard guidelines here in the image. The structure is, again, with a holistic perspective, you can see policies mentioned, the sign and approval of the program, the student-centered learning, the student admission, progression, recognition, certification, etc., teaching staff, the learning resources and student support, information management, and public information, not at least. And also, of course, the ongoing monitoring. So you can recognize what we, when I talked about this framework of the European Commission, the wheel with the 10 dimension, and also the report I mentioned when we studied the 40 quality models. So there are many of those issues which are coming back all the time. And you see both the teaching staff and student-centered learning are coming back. So in this report, there are those chapters I mentioned, and then there are some help. For example, just to show you, then there are some dimensions and some indicators which you can see, and you can make this self-evaluation. Oh, how is my institution working with this, for example, with policy and quality assurance? Is e-learning strategy embedded in the overall strategy? I mentioned that Anushka Ferrari said that there are no needs for any separate strategy on e-learning because it needs to be embedded. And this is exactly, this is one of the indicators. It needs to be embedded. Okay, I will not go into detail with this, but you can read it in the report. I will just show you the structure, so to say. And here are some of the other about student and teaching staff. So it's again, there are some kind of hints how what you can look at. And here about learning resources and student support and virtual mobility. And there's also about learning resources, for example, we talked about open education, how is open education resources used, what about open access, what about open science, open pedagogy, etc. And then we have the external quality assurance, how we can work with that. That is more for the agencies, and also how you can work with the implementing process and the peer review with peer review experts. Okay? And of course, the first point for the external quality assurance is to consider the internal quality assurance model. And here again, you can see some of the structure and some of the indicators which you can look at. For example, for designing the design area, flexible processes for include new modes of teaching and learning environment, innovation. This is one very important issue. Yes, and then about the peer review, of course, with working with others, and that is what benchmarking is about. So then maybe some of you know the Tesla project, which is also working about quality. And as you see in the Tesla, they have more or less, again, the same kind of dimensions like infrastructure resources, like student support, like teaching staff, like learning analytics, like public information. So you see from all those models I have shown you, there are different kind of dimensions which are coming back again and again. And that would, that of course, tell us something. And also all those frameworks are telling us that we need to have this holistic perspective on the ecosystem. Contact North, which is a very proactive organization in Canada, they are really arguing for that we need to look at quality in a different kind of way as we do for the moment. We need to look at learning over time, not just when students have finished their education or take their exams or their degree or whatever it is. And you see, engagement is one of the key drivers for quality. I mentioned Greta Thunberg, for example, and the issues of engagement. And they're also stressing that innovative, flexible, and effective use of technology, more in us, not just to use it to substitute things, but to use it in a smart way and with its possibilities. And not at least, change is not driven by technology, digitalization. It's driven by you and me. And the more knowledge we have about those issues about, in this case, about quality, we can be advocates and we can be change agents for new and renewing the quality agenda in education. So the more we know about those things and what quality is, what online learning is, what e-learning is, how we can look at it, what kind of perspectives we have to take into consideration, it can be stronger. So I'm coming to the end, and that is, I think in the quality agenda, there are also a new agenda. Who will shape the education? Is it the universities? Is it the governments? Is it the corporations? Or is it individuals? I myself, I think all of them. I would be happy to discuss this with you, but I think that the individuals will have a huge role in the future, and the future started yesterday.
Yes.
How we will look at quality, because at the end of the day, sorry, it's actually like, sorry? So in the end of the day, the individual spend time and money.
Difficult because...
Okay, I'm coming to the end, so I will mute my microphone and I will let you in, Antonella. So by that, thank you very much. And I will be happy to have some...
so much, Abba. It was so dense and interesting. There are so many things that I would like to discuss with you, and I'm sure we'll have the time during the Eden chat. But the first comment that I want to share with you this last minutes that we have is related to the concept of quality. Because you said, and actually from your presentation is so clear, that is a very complex concept, that of quality, and that it is related to so many different variables that it can be difficult to really find a definition for quality. So my question is, according to your experience, to your researches, to your everyday contact and work within this subject, what do you think? What would you recommend to us as educators to take into great care when we deal with quality issues?
So thank you very much, Antonella, for this very important question. You're really right. Of course, although the issue is complex and difficult, we can't ignore it. Rather, we really have to face it. And I will say that we need to shift the agenda to more look at what is mentioned from Contact North, the impact of the education and of the learning. What kind of impact is it? Not just that, you know, that people have passed and the C and so on, they have those graduates or whatever it is. Really, what is the impact? And again, the impact for the individual, the impact for the society, the impact for the working life. And I think also what I really strongly use to emphasize is that we Although it is complicated, we need to have this ecosystem. At least we need to try to focus both on the, like for example, in this model from the European Commission. I mean, 10 dimensions is not that much. You can manage that and you can have it in your hand to build a culture of quality. Then, of course, that model is not so easy as just 10 dimensions there. Then there are sub-dimensions, of course. But you can at least start there to see where can you start. And I think it is also good to make some kind of, you know, with all those models which are available, and most of them are available online, so you can measure your own status as well, and see where do you have the gaps, and maybe either you can try to strengthen what you're good in, and you can bit by bit try to make the gap smaller. And I think a huge difference to shape a new quality agenda is to take the learners' perspectives and what they are saying, and listen to them and work together with them when we are shaping a new quality agenda.
And I think after your feedback to Don, we'll have to close our webinar.
I see Don has a long comment here, and that is again about what I can understand about the quality, the culture. And again, although it is complex, we can start in small steps, and also each of us can do something, and then together we maybe can manage the full picture. But I think it is very important to lift it up a bit, to get some kind of overview, to get this ecosystem, because whatever we are dealing with or measuring or whatever we are doing, it will have an impact. As Jan Daniel was saying, this iron triangle, when you change something, the other shapes are changing as well. So I think we all have to work together on this rethinking the quality agenda, not least in higher education. So by that, thank you again, and thanks for having me. And hopefully we can continue later today.
Thanks for your time. All of you to our Eden chat at 6 p.m. Central Europe time. We'll have the opportunity to again discuss with Ebba some of the concepts that we have been developing today, and maybe this 1.5 hours time before the Eden chat, we can reflect on what we have been talking about together with Ebba and ask for more deepenings, references, and hints to take the issue of quality as, you know, a true and thanks to you all for participating. Thank you, Ebba, and see you in a while. Yeah.
Nella. Antonella, maybe last point. We have this Eden SIG special interest group on quality and TEL. So we have a special web page at Eden web pages, and we are a core group trying to work on this, but we're also welcoming, more people. So please, if you have an interest in the issues, please just contact me. And as I said, together we can be stronger and we can advocate better. So thank you again.
Special interest group. Thank you.
So, we need to message. Thank you again.